So, hello everybody. Here we have Pathfinder, the adventure card game, Wrath of the Righteous. And we are playing the base set. It starts with the adventure called Into the World Wound, which consists of five scenarios. And the first one we're playing is the Godless Ones. The Godless Ones is basically a scenario where you try to find allies that help you on your incursion into the World Wound, which is the first adventure that is also included in the base set. And you can see the box here. I've randomly drawn three party members. We have Aline, Imrika, and Sila. I called her Sheila yesterday. I apologize, of course, her name is Sila, and she is a human paladin. We have Imrika, who's a half-orc inquisitor, and we have Aline, who is a human cavalier. I've prepared their decks. I take the starting decks that come as a suggestion in the actual rule book. Now, the last thing that needs to be done is I need to put together the turn counter. So for this we draw 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. We draw 30, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 20, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 30. Random blessings, and we just put them next to the deck somewhere, or next to the playing area, it doesn't really matter. Everybody's got their start hands. They comply with the rules, which state that each character needs to have at least one of their favorite cards. So Ally needs at least one weapon, Imrika needs at least one blessing or weapon, and Sila needs at least one blessing. We have the setup for three characters. So the locations we will be visiting are the Armory, Forsaken Cloister, Manor House, Marketplace, Watchtower. You can also find all of this information on the Godless Ones card at the back. So it's a bit difficult because the camera's up there. And the Godless Ones information card is: the World Wounds demons would not be so confident about their chances of success without allies hidden amongst the people they prey upon. The demonologist Sofini and several of her Blackfyre adept minions want to bend demons to their will, show them whose will is strongest. So Sofini and her friends are the... Sofini is the villain in this scenario, and her henchmen are a Blackfyre adept, Susto Daimon, and cultists of Baphomet. So the location decks have all been prepared. I played the scenario yesterday and I won, but I didn't really... gain anything, or not much anyway, and I completely forgot to use the powers that each of these characters has printed on their character sheet, so hopefully we will be doing better this time. I've got my dice bag, which a friend of mine made for me. It's full of dice, so we will see how we fare today. We'll start with Sila, and she's a female human paladin, and she's really into blessings, so she is going to go into the Forsaken Cloister. And we're going to advance the turn track. We get a blessing of Shax. And Sila does her first exploration. And she encounters a barrier. It's a spiked pit trap. She can either defeat it by checking wisdom, perception, or dexterity, acrobatics. She's not really good at either of them. It says here, the difficulty to defeat is increased by the scenario's adventure deck number. This does not really have any impact now, because the scenario is B, which counts as a zero. If defeated, you may explore again. If undefeated, each character at this location is dealt 1d4 plus 1 combat damage, then end your turn. So what it says, and she's got a really special skill here, when you attempt a check before you act, and she's not acting yet because she's only explored, you may use your charisma skill instead of your any listed skill. So her charisma skill is actually D10 plus 1, which is much better than her wisdom, which is only D8. She doesn't have perception, and her dexterity is D4, so she could never ever use this. Let's see if she has anything that helps her with this. You may discard the top card of your deck to add 1d6 to any check by a character at your location. Okay, so she's going to use her d10 plus 1, and I'm going to discard the blessing of Ascension so that she gets 2d10. Because I really want her to explore, which she can't do if she doesn't succeed at this check. So here's a d10, 2d10. And she rolls an 8. Ugh. Plus 1, that's barely enough. 9. So she manages to get this barrier and pass this barrier, so so the card is banished, and she explores again. When you move or are moved here, you bury a card. She should have buried a card, so we're going to bury a card now, and yeah, I'm gonna bury the helm. Okay, so she's now encountering a boon. It's a lightning touch, which is magic, arcane, attack, electricity, basic. Now, we don't have any arcane people on our team, so it's not really important to get this. It's a d4 roll, so we are going to roll a d4, but if we don't, I'm not going to spend anything on this, because if we're not... if we don't get this, it's not the end of the world either. But if we do roll a 4, that would be cool. And we roll a 4. Wow, that's wow. So she acquires the lightning touch. Yeah, you can really only use it if you are a cane, but still it means that, you know, if she has to discard a card, let's say, or bury a card again, then she can actually get rid of this one. So we're going to discard this card, and we're going to draw up 2 more to get to her full hand size of 4. And she draws a blessing of Ascension and a quarterstaff. So this is her turn for now. So now we're going to move Imrika, and Imrika is really into interestingly enough, she is arranged. Her fighting skills are ranged, but the funny thing is she only has one ranged weapon. So I'm going to put her somewhere. I'm actually going to put her into the watchtower because she is quite powerful. She has a lot of weapons, and she's going to explore the watchtower. This location, the watchtower, is special in that instead of actually acquiring a boon trying to defeat the check that you need to acquire a boon, you can also defeat a random monster. So we're going to draw the first card, and it's a monster to begin with. It's a giant maggot swarm. Now this is actually one of the monsters for which there are errata cards, and I've actually cut them out and put them in here, which is why this may look a little bit weird. Before you act, each character at your location summons and encounters a giant maggot swarm. And before you act, the giant maggot swarm deals 1 acid damage to you. If you do not defeat the giant maggot swarm by at least 4, shuffle it into the deck it came from. The giant maggot swarm still counts as defeated. Okay, so basically she is already, she's alone at this location, so the first one doesn't work, but she does have to take one acid damage. Let's see. She has nothing to, yeah, so she's going to discard this card to take the one damage. And now she's going to, I'm just going to use her strength skill, which is 10. I'm going to discard this card because it gives a plus d6. It gives her 2 plus d6, and any 6 that she rolls on a d6 will count as a 7. So, she gets a d10. She gets a d10 plus 2 d6, and she needs to roll a 6. And she actually succeeds beautifully. She has a 7, 9, 9. That's good. And she can now also roll, and this is a special power. If you defeat a monster on your turn, you may roll a d6 on a 5, 4, or 6. You explore your location again. And she rolls a 2, of course. So that ends her turn. She now, oh, did I actually draw up to her hand size? Yes, I did. She draws up to her hand size, which is 5. So she draws another blessing and she draws a javelin. And that ends Imrika's, Imrika's turn. So now we have Aline. And Aline is going to go to... Not somewhere where he needs... Oh, yeah, he's going to go somewhere where he can get allies. So he's going to go to the... to the manor house. When you encounter a boon of a type other than loot here, draw a random boon of that type from the box, encounter one and banish the other. Summon and acquire a random ally in order to close. Okay, so let's see. So he's really good at this because, okay, so we get a Horn of Battle Clarity. Recharge this card to add 1d4 to any combat check by character at your location, or 1d8 if you also reveal an ally or cohort that has the Hireling or Soldier trait. Discard this card to search for your discard pile for an ally or cohort that has the Hireling or Soldier trait from your discard pile. Shuffle it into your deck. Okay, this is a really good one which we really want. The test is charisma, melee, or ranged. His charisma is d8 plus 3, but his strength and melee is d10 plus 2. So he can get a 12 maximum, and then he can get an 11. So we now need to draw a random item, which we do, and we can encounter one or the other. The second one is a book of the Law Master. Intelligence or knowledge? Well, you know, he's not really the most intelligent guy. Discard this card to add 1d6 to any knowledge. No, we're not going to do that. We're going to get this, or hopefully get this. So, let's see his card deck. Should I? No, I'm gonna risk it. So that's a d10 plus 2. And we roll a 6 plus 2 is 8, so he gets the Horn of Battle Cry. And he's going to he's going to play his discard his Blessing of Ascension to explore one more time. Oh, and I forgot to actually advance the turn track. This is something that happens all the time. Okay, so let's see. What do we see? Oh, we get a spell. Create Pit. It's a magic arcane trap basic. Intelligence arcane. Well, he can try to acquire it. His intelligence is 6. Is a d6. And he actually rolls a 6. Brilliant. So he just acquired a spell. Great. So now we need to look at his hand. He's got 6 cards, so he now needs to discard down to 4. We're going to get rid of the Create Pit. And we're going to discard the Horn of the Battle Clarity, and that ends his turn. So now it's Sela again. We're going to turn over the turn track. She is going to explore this deck, and she is encountering a blessing, which of course she would like to get, and she can get it on a divine check, which is d8 plus d8 plus 1. And she rolls a 5, and she has 6, that is enough. So she acquires this particular Blessing of Pullura. She can discard this card to add 1 die to any check, we know this. Recharge this card to ignore the abyssal or corrupted trait on a card until the end of your turn. Discard this card to explore your location. After you play this card, if it matches the top card of the Blessing discard pile, recharge this card instead of discarding it. That's really good. Unfortunately, it doesn't, but what we're going to be doing is we're going to discard the Blessing of Ascension to explore one more time. And we encounter the Cultist of Baphomet. Now this is a henchman. So when we defeat the henchman, we can close the location immediately. I don't know if we want to do this though. The difficulty of this check to defeat the Cultist of Baphomet is increased by the scenario's adventure deck number. That doesn't really apply to us because the adventure deck number is 0. Before you act, if this is your first exploration of the turn, which it isn't, the Cultist of Baphomet deals 1 combat damage to you. If undefeated, blah, blah, blah. If defeated, you may immediately attempt to close this location. So, 10. Melee 10. So, basically, what we're going to be doing is we're going to look at her weapons. And she has a d8 plus 3. And here we have the long spear, which allows her to, when it's revealed, and revealing just means basically showing it, that she gets a plus 1d8, and if she fails the check, she can then discard this card to re-roll the dice. So she's getting a d8 for her strength. 1, 8, and the second d8, and we're going to roll, and she needs a 10, and she rolls a 9 plus the plus 3 for her melee means she has 12, so the Cultist of Baphomet is defeated. So she goes back into the box. And Sela can now close this location, which she is not going to do, because it means that she needs to summon this adventure's demon. And that's not what she wants to do. Demon Servitor. So she's not going to do this. She has a hand of 4. She doesn't need to reset her hand or anything. So now it's Imrika's turn, and she's going to explore in the watchtower, and she finds a javelin, which is a ranged weapon, which is good for her because she's very good with range, and she's going to try and acquire it. Okay, so her ranged is d10. Plus 1, she needs to roll a 4, And she gets 8 in total. So she acquires the javelin. So she's going to discard her blessing of ascension to explore one more time, and she encounters the barrier Baleful Shadows. In order to defeat this, she needs to check the Wisdom, Divine, or Stealth traits. A divine card. A divine check is, well, it's D9. Oh, D8 plus 1. That's not gonna. Okay, so she's going to discard the blessing of ascension to face this. So she's gonna get 2d8. Oh, and she rolls a 5, that's not enough. If undefeated, a character at your location summons and encounters the henchman White. So let's encounter the White. It's actually a very beautiful card. If I can find it. Somewhere in here, I saw you the other day. White, show yourself. So if you would like to actually just look at this beautiful artwork here. Ugh. This is actually a really beautiful White. So, we're going to encounter this White now. Combat 10 or Wisdom Divine 8. The White is immune to the mental and poison traits. Before you act, the White deals 1 cold damage to a random character at your location. When a character is dealt damage, she buries those cards instead of discarding them. If defeated, you may immediately attempt to close the location. This is something that we need to ignore. So she needs to bury 1 card. Oh god, she's gonna bury the sickle. Okay. Yeah, okay. So, for your combat check, bury this card to use your dexterity or range skill plus 2d6. This is what we're going to be doing. We're going to bury this card. We're not going to banish it. So she gets 2d6 plus d10 plus 1. And she rolls a 10, 12. That's enough to get rid of the White. Now, if she doesn't defeat the... And she didn't defeat the barrier, so I suppose... This goes back in, so we put it back in, and we shuffle the deck. Okay, Imlika now needs to redraw her hand. She has a hand of 5, 3, 5. Okay, 2 blessings of ascension, not too bad. So now it's Aline, and Aline is still in the manor house where he's exploring, and he explores and finds a glaive. He needs to now draw a second boon of that type, which is actually a weapon. So we're just gonna draw a random weapon, which is a sickle. Now, a glaive is a polearm, which is melee, which is what he's good at. It's slashing, two-handed magic, elite. And for your combat check, reveal this card to use your strength or melee skill plus 1d10 plus 1. If not proficient, blah blah blah. So yeah, this is a weapon that he would really like to acquire, and in order to do so, he needs to strength or melee 11. Why did I actually not? Why do I have 4 cards? Oh, that's the discard card. Okay. Okay, let's see what we can do here. Okay, this is difficult because he doesn't have anything to help him. So what we're going to be doing is we're going to be using one of the blessings of ascension from Imrika to give him an additional d10. So he's got 2d10. And he rolls a 10 plus his melee is a 2, so 12, so he acquires this 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 weapon, which is really good. So now it's over to Sila again, and Sila will explore, and she encounters an ally. Wisdom, survival, charisma, diplomacy. Yeah, she has no way of actually acquiring this one, so that's also not so important, really. Yeah, so we're just not going to do anything with this. But she can now decide to close this, and she will actually do this. So she will summon a demon link. And the combat for this is 8. So let's see what happens when you summon a demonling. The demonling is immune to the electricity and poison traits. Before you act, succeed at a wisdom or perception check 7. All the demonling may not be evaded, and the difficulty of checks to the defeat of the demonling is increased. So what we're going to be doing is we're going to be using our blessing that we acquired earlier to give her an additional d8 for her check. And she rolls a 15, so that's fine. And now she's going to fight this demonling. And it's got a combat strength of 8. It's not that strong, so she has a melee of d8, and she's going to use the long spear, which is going to give her a d8 in addition. Oops. We're gonna roll, and we roll a 9 plus her 3 is 12, so the demonling is defeated, and now we will close this location. And there was still a fire blade, which is this would have been a divine spell, a blessing of Shelin, a demon hunter's handbook, the monster vampire spawn. They are actually quite deadly with 13 and hide armor. Okay, well, you know, the spell would have been interesting because we haven't acquired any spells yet. So, but yeah, so just gonna put these back in the box where they belong. So, and the blessing of Shelin goes in here, and then we have the demon hunter's book, which is an item which goes in here. So, we have now closed the Forsaken Cloister. This isolated monastery was once a place of refuge for those seeking spiritual enlightenment. But all such aspirations were abandoned long ago. Those who once sought redemption here have lost their way, and they have lost their home. Despite their fall from grace, desperate crusaders still seek this refuge. Demons prey on pilgrims and penitents, but those who survive such predations faintly hope this forsaken cloister can restore their souls, just as crusaders persist in their endless struggle to restore the lands around it. Okay, so now what we're going to be doing is we're going to replenish her hand. So we're drawing 1, and she gets a blessing of ascension. And now it's turn track, and Imrika is going to explore at the watchtower, and she encounters a magic scale mail. Constitution, fortitude 5. What's her constitution? Her constitution is d6. She can also draw recharge this card to reduce a combat damage dealt to you by 2 or 3 if the damage is dealt to you before you or after you act. Do we want to actually encounter a random monster instead to acquire this? Yes, we're going to do that. So I'm just going to take the monster deck. I'm going to play around with it for a little bit. I'm going to draw a really random card from the middle, and it's a giant cockroach. And she's going to use her D10. And she's going to reveal her javelin. No, she's actually going to use her bow. 1d6. And she rolls a 6, which is not enough, so she actually does not acquire the magic scale mail, and it goes into the box. Well, it was a nice try, but then again, I'm not gonna bury the javelin just to acquire something that she actually needs, and that is a weapon. Let's see, is she going to... No, she's not going to explore again. She's just going to draw up to her hand size. And then we're going to get Aline's turn. Oh, and actually the music stopped. And if you were wondering what I've been listening to, I've actually decided to get myself really into the mood. And I have gotten the Conan, Age of Conan's soundtrack. So let's see what Aline encounters at the manor house. He encounters a wooden shield. Constitution, fortitude, 4. His constitution is a d8, so we can easily try that. It's not something that we desperately need, so we're not going to spend anything. And he rolls a 5, which is enough. So Aline now has a wooden shield. He now needs to discard down to his hand size, which is 5, so he needs to get rid of the wooden shield, and he's gonna discard the sickle, the yeah, no, he's actually going to discard the sickle. Okay, so oh yeah, and you should also have seen this, the other oh, actually, we're going to do this again because I forgot to give him the other boon. So we're going to try it this time round. Constitution, fortitude. Let's try this again. And he rolls a 5, so actually both go back in the box. Because I would have acquired the magic shield that wasn't meant to be. Okay, now it's again our friend Sila. So we turn over the turn track. And Sila is going to... Where is she going to? She could go to the armory. And she's going to go to the armory. And she's going to explore there. When you acquire a weapon, you may draw a card. So... Oh, here's a lance. Strength, melee. Okay, let's see. For your combat check, reveal this card to use your strength or melee skill plus d8. You may additionally discard this card to add another d6. If you're not proficient with weapons, the difficulty of this check is increased by 4. On this check, you may reveal a card that has the mount trait to ignore the two-handed trait on this card. If you do, and this is your first combat check to the turn, add another 1d8 to your check. It is a very powerful weapon. So what we're going to be doing is we're going to do a melee check. And we roll a 7 plus 3 is 10, so she acquires the lance, which is really good. And she has a card. Yeah, she's going to use the blessing to explore one more time, and she, oh yeah, and she now can draw a card if she likes, but she doesn't want to. And now we have a hand crossbow, which would be really cool for Imrika. So we're going to acquire this dexterity or range. Her dexterity is d4, so yeah, it's not gonna happen. Unless Imrika has a blessing. Do we want to risk this? It's the question. yeah, we are going to risk this because this is a very powerful weapon. So, considering that this is a beginner's game. Oh, and we roll a 5, which is enough. So she acquires the crossbow. And she's going to discard the crossbow because she's not really going to use it. And that's all she's going to do. At her location. So next up we have Imrika, who is still at the watchtower where she's going to now explore. And she comes across a steel shield. Constitution or Fortitude 5. Her constitution is a D6 steel shield. Okay, we're going to try this anyway. She has a D6, but we're not going to add anything to it. And she rolls a 6, which is enough, so she acquires the steel shield. And she has a hand size of 5 now, so that's fine, so we're not going to do anything. And she's going to wait here until her turn. Turn track advances, and it's Aline at the manor house with the club. And he encounters the Susto Daimon, who is a henchman, so he can actually then close this location. The Susto Daimon is immune to acid, mental, and poison traits. Well, that's fine. If evaded, shuffle this monster. No, we're not going to try and evade it. Before you act, the Susto Daimon deals 1 fire damage to you. Okay, so we're going to have to discard a card to take this damage. We're going to use the Scale Mail, recharge this card to reduce... Oh, well, it's just for combat damage. Ah, yeah, well, we're going to just discard this card. So, okay. So he has a combat check of 12. That's actually a powerful one. We're going to use our glaive plus 1. For your combat check, reveal this card to use. So basically we have our D10 for our melee. And we get another D10 for revealing this. Yeah, here we go. And we're also going to put Donahan on top of our reveal this card. Put this card on top of your deck to add a 1d8 plus the scenario's adventure deck number to your combat check that has the melee trait. That's what we're going to be doing. So we're going to add a d8. Where is it? D8. Here we go. So we roll now. And we roll a 10, 16, 19, plus 2 is 21, plus 3 is 22. So this Susto Daimon is banished and sent back to the abyss. He's gone. Take that. And now we need to, we can immediately close this by summoning and acquiring a random ally. So we're going to take the ally deck and we're going to randomly acquire one guy or girl. It's a Black Wing Librarian. Diplomacy 8. Whoopsie. Can we do this? What is our diplomacy? I think he's quite diplomatic, isn't he? Yeah, D8 plus 3. Okay. Now, fingers crossed. And we roll a 6 plus 3 is a 9, that's enough. So we also acquire a Blackwing Librarian. And Blackwing Librarians do the following. You can recharge this card to succeed at your check against a boon that has the arcane trait. That's cool. Discard this card to explore your location. So if you want to acquire a spell, for example, that has... If Aline wants to acquire a spell that has the arcane trait, he can actually just recharge this card to get the boon without having to roll, which is good because he doesn't have the arcane knowledge. So now we've closed this location, so we're just going to look through it. There would have been a riding horse, ally, codex, rallying cry barrier, short bow, and Blackwing Librarian. So nothing really special to worry about that we didn't get it. And we didn't meet the barrier, which is not so bad because the barrier was difficult. Would have been probably quite difficult. So. Okay, so the manor house is now closed. Mender's most elaborate estates have fallen on hard times. Wealthy landowners can no longer count on their safety or security. Instead, travellers come and go across their lands. Vast manor houses are now way stations for pilgrims and wanderers, though some of them are decidedly unfriendly. If you're particularly diplomatic, you might acquire a few boon companions while passing through a neglected estate. If you aren't, of course, you might suddenly attract some new enemies. Okay, well, Aline is very diplomatic, so he managed to do this. Let's look at his hand. He's got 3, but his hand size is 4, so he's now going to draw 1 more. And of course, that's Donahan, because we put Donahan on top of his deck. Good. Aline, on his next turn, will move someplace else. So now it's Sela again, and she's going to keep exploring the armory. And she encounters the cultist of Baphomet, which means that she can now actually, if she wants to, close the location. Was going to do 1 combat damage, recharge this card to reduce combat damage dealt to you by 2. So we're just going to recharge this card, which means it goes to the bottom of our draw deck. And now we're going to give this person hell. We're going to use the... We're going to use the lance, we're going to use the long spear. 1d8 is added, and she already has 1d8, so now we're going to roll. We need a 10. Actually, no, we're going to discard the lance to get an additional d6, because we really want to get rid of this woman, of this... cultist. And we roll a 4, 5, 8. So that's 13 plus her melee is 3 is 16. So the cultist is defeated. Take that. So now we can try and close this by summoning and acquiring a random weapon. So now that's interesting. You actually get a weapon from the deck out of the box and you try to acquire it. Oh god, this could be difficult because it's a dexterity-based check. Okay. Her dexterity is D4. Okay, what we're going to be doing is we're going to be using her special skill. You may discard the top card of your deck to add a D6 to any check by a character at your location. That's a wooden shield, that's fine. So it's a D4 plus a D6. And she rolls a 4, which is just enough to get the short bow, and that is enough to close the armory. So now we're going to look at what we are missing. We didn't get the frog, we didn't get the magic padded armor, we didn't get the heavy crossbow, or the corrosive dagger, or the corroded helm, or the stalking armor, or the stalking armor times 2. And there's a lot of armor. Well, it was 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, yeah. So basically we didn't get any of the armor that was in there, but that's just as well. And the frog. It's an interesting ally, a frog. So now we're going to turn over the armory, we're going to close it. Faith and knowledge are powerful weapons, but sometimes all you really want when you're standing against a horde of demons is a sharpened blade of cold, a hard steel. When armies prepare for their latest crusades, they seize any weapons they can find. There's no shortage of implements of destruction in this armory, but heroes who scavenge here might walk away with exotic weapons they've never seen before. So let's look at her hand. Her hand is 3. And she's going to draw up to her hand size, which is 4, and she draws a long sword. So she's really, you know, she should go someplace where she needs to fight, because now she's all weapons. Next turn, it's Imrika, who's still at the watchtower, and she explores there, and she draws the bolas, which is a ranged weapon, which is what she's into. So let's do this. Her ranged is d10 plus 1. And she rolls a 2 plus 1 is 3, so she doesn't get them. Shame. Goes back in. And she can't do anything to actually keep exploring. So she has to stay where she is. Now it's Alain. He'll go to the marketplace because that's the only other open location. And he's going to explore. Now at the marketplace, when you attempt to acquire a boon, add +1 to the scenario's adventure deck number to checks to acquire it. So, yeah. Let's see. Explore and we meet a holy phylactery. Divine 6+1. He's not going to be able to acquire this at all because his divine, he doesn't have the divine trait. So, yeah. He can just basically throw this out. Does he have a blessing? No, so he can't even... Oh, he can discard the black wing... Does it have the arcane trait? No, it doesn't. You can discard the black wing librarian to explore straight away again, and he explores and finds a vulture, which he could acquire if he's using his wisdom or survival. Well, I mean, he's got a d6, we can always try. And he rolls a 3, which is not enough, so the vulture goes back in the box. And Alain draws up to his heart a card size, and he gets the Ring of Climbing. So Alain is at the marketplace, and Imrika... and now it's Sila's turn. She's going to move to the marketplace as well. And she's going to explore there. And she explores and finds a retainer. It's an elf hireling, charisma or diplomacy. Well, she has a d10+1. So, and she rolls a 6, a 5+1 is 6, so she gets the elf hireling, which allows her to recharge this card to add 1d4 to your check to acquire a weapon, an armor, an item, or an ally. And she can discard this to explore her location, which she's going to do. So she's going to make a second exploration. And she encounters a Wand of Paralyze. Intelligence, arcane, wisdom, divine. Bury this card to evade a non-villain monster you encounter. Put it on the top or bottom of its location deck. After playing this card, you may succeed at an arcane or divine 12 check to recharge this card instead of burying it. I don't know. I mean, it's kind of nice, but, you know, who wants to evade monsters? Certainly not a paladin. We meet them head on. We don't evade them, but we will try anyways. Intelligence, d4, wisdom, 8+1. Yeah, that's not gonna... It's not gonna make any difference. You can't acquire this. Okay, well. And it's also 10+1, so it's not going to happen. So this is an item, we'll put it back into the item box. And Sheila has finished her exploration at the marketplace. So now it's Alain. Now it's Imrika. Next turn, she's still at the watchtower, going slowly through the deck. And she's encountering the Baleful Shadows. Divine Wisdom Stealth. Oh God. Does she have a blessing? No, she does not. Does anybody here have a blessing? Does anybody have a blessing? No. Okay, well, she can't really... closes. So we have to summon a white again and fight the white. Cold damage. So she needs to discard a card. She needs to bury this card. She's going to attack. Oh no! Recharge this card to reduce cold or combat damage dealt to you. So we're gonna recharge. Okay, so we're going to bury it and we're going to attack this white. It's 10. Yeah, we're going to use this, so it's d8 plus d4 plus d10. Six, nine, 11. The white's gone, the white's history. Somebody needs to help her there because she's basically, if she encounters this one more time, she draws up to her hand size. The baleful shadows go back into the shadows. Woo-hoo-hoo. And yeah, this is a really horrible barrier. So look at the amount of cards she's already buried. That's not fun. So now it's Aline's. Aline is actually going to go to help Imrika at the watchtower. So he's going to reveal the first card. And it's the Baleful Shadows. Wisdom Divine. Well, he's also not really wisdom-y. And he's also, yeah, well, you know. Is there anything we can do? Combat. Nothing. Okay, let's summon a white. And let's kill this white. First we'll take one damage and bury a card. We're going to bury the Ring of Climbing. Nobody really needs this. Let's put it in there. It's gone. One d10. Five. Seven, eight. We're going to discard this card. We can actually recharge it because it's a weapon to re-roll. That's what we're going to be doing. Okay, that sucked. That roll sucked. Oops. Five, six, eight. So we take two damage. Ugh. Now we discard everything, so we basically recharge the weapon. Yeah. And we draw up to our hand size. I mean, this barrier sucks. That is really tough. Okay, so the white goes away. The Baleful Shadows go back into the shadows. And make our lives hell, I'm sure. I don't understand this. Maybe Sia should go there because, I mean, well, yeah, her wisdom is also not strong enough to fight this. This is a really tough one. Let's hope that we don't encounter it again. New round, it's Sila, and she's going to explore at the manor house, and she gets an Abyssal Traveler's Kit, intelligence or knowledge. She doesn't have either. Okay. Yeah, so she's not going to do this, and that would be nice, but no, she's just not cut out for this kind of thing. She also doesn't have anything that allows her to explore again. Yeah, so she's going to stay where she is. Imrika's turn. Let's see what happens. We encounter Sofini. Yay, that is the villain. First, we need to summon and encounter a random monster. And we encounter a pit-born scoundrel, combat 12. Before you act, if you are the only character at your location, no, that's not the case. Will you act while you act, damage dealt by the pit-born scoundrel may not be reduced. Okay, this has a 12. So what we're going to be doing is, Imreka is going to... she's going to attack the pit-born scoundrel with her ranged skill, so she gets a d10. The short bow is revealed, d6. And in addition, she's going to discard the, banish the caltrop beads to get a d4 on her combat check. And now, please, all, hold your, keep your fingers crossed and hold your breath. 9, 14, 15, that's plenty. The pit-born scoundrel is gone, but now we need to attack Sofini. We're going to... bury this card. So first of all, we're going to use our range, which is 10. We're burying this card to get 2d6 in addition. And then we are going to... reveal the Sage's Journal to add a d4 to our check to defeat a henchman or villain. So, a d4. Now give him hell. Give her hell. We need a 12. Oh god. We roll a 6, 10, 11, 12, plus 1 is 13. Just about. Just about. Sofini is... is defeated. Now we need to check if she can actually flee, and we first of all we need to see if Sela can close, can temporarily close the marketplace. So we take a boon. Okay, so let's see. On a 1, it's a weapon. On a 2, it's a spell. On a 3, it's an armor. On a 4, it's an item. On a 5... okay, we're gonna roll. Okay, it's a d8. On a 2, it's a spell, which we need to acquire. Intelligence, Arcane, Wisdom, Divine, 8. Roll a d8. And she manages to acquire this, because it's got a 7, her strength is 8, so it's got a 6 plus 1 is 7, she has an 8. So she manages to temporarily close the marketplace, so Sofini cannot escape. So Sofini is defeated, and we can now close... oh, when we close the... if undefeated shuffle... okay. When you defeat the villain, you close the location immediately. So we turn over, the location of Watchtower is now closed. We just check what else is in the box. Teamster and Bat, Blasphemous Priest and Baleful Shadows. I mean, this is a really bad barrier. Seriously. Okay, so I'm glad that I didn't have to encounter the Baleful Shadow barrier again, because that would have meant bearing even more cards. And I have to look up what it actually means when you bury a card. So the watchtower is now closed. Heroes often go looking for trouble. Standing on the parapets of a watchtower makes searching for it a little easier. Crusaders scan the horizon from their lofty vantage point, looking for signs and suggesting that danger and the rewards that come from defeating it are nearby. Truly idealistic crusaders don't require material rewards for their fight against evil. The chance to hunt down and destroy the minions of the world wound is far more rewarding than any bauble, trinket, gewgaw, or other form of remuneration. Okay. Our friend, oh god, we're actually almost dead. Imrika only has 2 more cards, and she needs to draw up to 5, and she gets a blessing of ascension and detect demon skill, spell. So Imrika now stays where she is, and it's Alain's turn, and he moves into the marketplace to assist Sila. So he's going to explore. And it's a mirror image skill, spell. Well, it's an arcane thing, intelligence arcane. Well, he is. He can't really acquire this. There is no way because his intelligence is a D6 and this is an 8. Yeah, so this goes back into the box. He's going to use the riding horse to explore again. Scale mail. 5. Constitution, fortitude. D8. Let's try this. He rolls a 5. That is enough. He acquires the scale mail and he uses his recruit to explore one more time. And he encounters a heavy crossbow. Dexterity ranged. It's not going to be able to acquire this. It goes back in the box. He draws up to his hand size 4, and Alain waits at the marketplace. Sila is now going to explore, and she encounters a hand crossbow. Dexterity ranged 5 plus 1 is 6. Her dexterity is a D4. It's not gonna happen. She doesn't have a blessing she can use. Does anybody have a blessing? Imrika does. Yeah, so she's going to discard a blessing of ascension to help Sila with this test, which is 2d4 at this stage. So let's see. It's going to be difficult, but God knows. Well, 5. Yeah, that was unfortunately not good enough. Okay, so we're going to put this back in the box. Can Sila explore again? No, she can't. Her hand size is 4, so she needs to discard one card, and it's now Imrika's turn. Let's look at Imrika's hand. Imrika's gonna stay put, she's not gonna do anything. Alain is going to explore in the marketplace where he is, and he explores and finds the Blackfire Adept, the last henchman. Before you act, a character at your location summons and encounters this adventure's servitor demon. If the demon is not defeated, the Blackfire Adept is undefeated. Okay. So, this is going to be interesting now. Let's get the Demonling out. Demonling, show yourself, I know you're there. The Demonling is immune, bloody, bloody, blah, wisdom or perception check. Yeah, that's gonna be difficult. Yeah, he fails. So now he has an 11. Okay. So he's going to, use a D10. And he rolls a 9, 10, and he also rolls a d6. Sorry, I forgot this, but that's enough anyway, even on his base skill. So the Demon Link is destroyed. But now we need to encounter the Blackfire Adept, and she's got a combat of 11. No, actually, 11, and we rolled a 9, 11, yeah, that's just it, okay. So basically now Aline has to defeat this Blackfire Adept, so use this. He's gonna discard it so that he gets a second, but being ally, he doesn't have to discard it, he can actually put it in here and recharge it. And we're also going to use a Blessing of Ascension to add one more d10 to this check. And we roll, 14, 15, 16, that's enough to get rid of the Blackfire Adept. So that was really the last card. So now we need to close this location. And we close this by choosing a random, okay, let's roll a d8. I roll a 4, that's a 1, 2, 3, that's an item. We just take any item from the box and we need to acquire this. It's a potion of beast skin, intelligence craft 5. Well, he's got a d6. Does anybody have a blessing? No. 5, that's enough. He acquires the potion of beast skin. Brilliant. And we close the final location and we have won the first scenario. Again, it was hard, and now I have to check what happens to cards that have been buried. Do you actually get to look at them between games, or what happens to them? Put it under your character card, likely losing access to it for the rest of the scenario. Okay, that's fine. So it's just for the rest of the scenario. So between games, you can actually then access your buried cards. So this means that we're now done. Since we have managed to win the scenario, each person gets a corrupted random blessing. I'm just going to go through this. Divine Shaxx corrupted. That's going to go to Sila. Baphomet goes to Imrika. And another Baphomet goes to our friend, Aline. So what now happens is the guys return from their first outing, and now they're going to go to a tavern where they're going to look at all of the things that they have acquired. So basically everybody looks at their cards. That they now have. It's more than the 15 that they set out with. So for example, Sila now has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23 cards. And of course you can only have 15. So now we're going to go through all of her cards to see which ones she's going to keep. She needs to still fulfill her card requirements, her deck requirements, but she may replace some of her starting equipment with acquired equipment because that may be much better. Let's look at Imrika. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. She's only acquired 2 additional cards, so We'll see if there are any in there that are important. And also, they can now freely trade. So they can now say, okay, somebody acquired, let's say, this spell.
Okay, that's an arcane spell. Nobody, one can see if this is a good idea to give it to somebody else. Now let's look at our friend Aline. Aline has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22. He's also acquired a couple of really interesting cards. He's acquired 7 cards, or 6 actually. So this is going to happen off camera. And then I have my character's deck for the next one. For the next scenario, which will be, or which is called, the Elven Entanglement. So everything goes back into the box, and I hope you enjoyed watching this. I have to say, I find this game is tough. I mean, as you saw, this barrier is almost, well, it cannot be overcome by the people I'm playing with, so they're just not strong enough in the divine magic trade. They don't have enough items, or not at the right time to solve this problem. But I hope you got an insight into the mechanics of the game, and you may also have noticed that it plays fairly quickly. So it is an interesting game, and it's in my opinion very very evocative as well. So if you are into RPGs and you can't get an RPG group together, and you're also willing to go through a story with your characters that's going to take time for them to develop and become stronger, like an RPG, then I believe that this is a game that you will find interesting and you should definitely check out. So that's all from me now, and I wish you a pleasant Saturday.